He left behind much more than his music. Mr. Showmanship's true legacy is his trademark sparkle that predated glitter rock by more than a decade. On his last interview for Lifestyles, Liberace told us he wanted to create a souvenir video, one in which friends and fans could step into his world and enjoy his bedazzling possessions collected over a lifetime. This is it, for the first time on television. So, at Lee's request, we invite you to sit back, wear shades if you must, and enjoy what, next to his music, he truly loved. Snip of the scissors by good friend Debbie Reynolds marked the beginning of an auction and the end of an era. It launched his last hurrah. Much of the world's most famous collection of glitterama went under the hammer. It was a going, gone marathon Liberace would truly have appreciated. Who else but Lee could pull off one last super showy extravaganza after he'd gone?
When you look at the massive collection here, you can see he had wonderful taste in every style. He really just loved beautiful things, and certainly not predicting an early death for himself. He collected extensively, so this will be one of their largest auctions that they probably ever had, other than William Randolph Hearst.
He'd buy everything. He always did. His philosophy was, if it has a blank space on it, put something on it.
Liberace bought nothing but the best, yet he told us his buying binges weren't by any means random.
I'm a collector, that's true, but more than that, I'm a person that has to have a project. I'm always building something or restoring something, and I'm always involved in a project other than my entertainment work.
When Liberace first walked into this Los Angeles penthouse, it hadn't been lived in for over 17 years. It was, in his words, what you'd call a dump. But Lee was a master showman with unique talent and taste. And even to the amazement of his closest friends, he transformed this apartment into one of Hollywood's most fashionable addresses.
Inspired by the breathtaking penthouse view, it was easy for Liberace to outdazzle even Hollywood's glitz. Little touches, like a black mink piano stool cover to match the king-size mink bedspread, put him light years ahead. Baccarat crystal table was once owned by an Indian Maharaja, but don't think Liberace was always this formal. A limo ride away, his beachfront condo was always kept ready. By Mr. Showmanship's terms, this was where he lived, simply. The celebrated Las Vegas villa, Liberace's favorite home of them all, plus a first ever tour of his Spanish-style home, the one he called the Cloisters. But first, back to Robin at the All-Star Auction Block.
The auction is over, and Liberace's celebrated possessions have been dispersed all over the world. But when we return, one final exclusive look at his treasured collection. Stay with us. It took just a few days to disperse what took Liberace a lifetime to collect. His treasured possessions are now scattered throughout the world. But it takes only two accessories to recall his legendary talent. A concert grand piano is how he made the music, and a showy candelabra illuminated his one-of-a-kind razzle-dazzle.
The magnificent obsession began after he saw a movie about the life of Chopin. If the Polish composer could have a pair of candelabras, then the maestro from Milwaukee could have dozens, hundreds even. Liberace's collection eventually became the most extensive in the world. When it came to pianos, he was an equally avid collector. With 10 strings to every note, his rare Blüthner is the only one of its kind left. In his last interview, he once told us,
"This is one of my prized possessions. It's a real museum piano. It's a Pleyel, and it was played on by Chopin and Franz Liszt during their lifetime. And it is quite a collector's item."
For the master pianist, size really didn't matter. In addition to his beloved collection of grands and baby grands, he also amassed thousands of miniature pianos from every corner of the world. Because his home turf was Las Vegas, his dazzling Nevada villa grew to become the most flamboyant of his six homes.
When I first moved here, it was just one little small sort of a townhouse. And I fell in love with the look of it, but then after I lived here a while, it was so small, I kept adding rooms onto it. And then it was still small, so I kept adding houses to it. I bought the next house, and then I made it all one complex.
The Vegas villa will best be remembered for one unique extravagance. Among his most treasured collections was an authentic Napoleon and Josephine dinnerware set for 12. He kept it at his nearby Tivoli Gardens restaurant.
I never really feel that I own these things. I feel they've been placed in my care to look after for future generations to enjoy. You don't really own them. You're a caretaker for these things. And when I think of all the people who had them before me, I feel privileged to be amongst such illustrious historical company.
Though he spent untold millions on his collections, Liberace wasn't just another wealthy pushover.
Fortunately, most of the things that I've collected, I collected before they were so desirable. I used to go antiquing when you could really find bargains. I have never met a person of means who wasn't a bargain hunter. And that includes Jackie Onassis.
The piece de resistance of the Vegas villa is pure Liberace. Take a look at the ceiling in the master bedroom. It's Lee to a T.
I met this Italian painter who had done a restaurant, and he recreated some of the Michelangelo characters. So for 5.5 months, he was on a scaffold on his back, painting the ceiling in my bedroom. And he painted the Sistine Chapel, with apologies to Michelangelo.
For the first time on television, and the last time it will ever be seen intact, we exclusively present the home he called the Cloisters.
My home in Palm Springs is probably my most favorite home, because this is a home that was destined to be a parking lot for the Catholic Church and the Jewish synagogue, which borders it. It's filled with antiques and some very priceless things that I have acquired through the years. I have a desk, for instance, in Palm Springs that belonged to Tsar Nicholas II of Russia.
Beyond eclectic, his collection spans as many centuries as schools of art. One room is dedicated to a silent screen hero who had special meaning for him.
My mother was a Valentino fan. I mean, she named my kid brother after him, Rudolph. And my middle name was Valentino. In Palm Springs, I have a Rudolph Valentino room and so forth with all his memorabilia.
Though much of his memorabilia was auctioned off, fans shouldn't feel sad that much of his lifetime's collection is split up. Who else but Lee could afford the complete inventory? And judging by a typical winning bid for each treasure, consider how many lucky fans now own a piece of the legend. His most treasured collectibles still remain at his museum. It generates millions for the Liberace Foundation for the Performing Arts. Young students who are now able to pursue their dreams can thank far-sighted generosity of the ultimate showman. For the rest of us, we need only be thankful for the man and his music. He brought joy to millions. It's easy to remember a star who's simply unforgettable.
I don't care if it's August, December, or June.
A showman for eternity.